you don't have one of those, you need to beg me for it, and I'll share it with you. And I'm sure you can talk me into giving it to you. Isn't God good today? If God didn't want to heal you, why did he do it? 1 Peter 2:24, it says, by whose stripes you were healed. If God didn't want you to be rich, why did he become poor for your sake? 2 Corinthians 8, verse 9, though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. If God didn't want you to have power over the devil, why did he give it to you? Amen. Luke 10:19. Behold, I give you power over all the power of the devil. If God wanted you to be alone, why did he promise never to leave you? Hebrews 13:5. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Everybody say amen. Amen. It's amazing to me that today, in this wonderful year and day of enlightenment, and more people hear sermons all the time now, more than we ever heard, than my grandmother heard in her lifetime. We hear more sermons in a week than what many people ever heard. But I am amazed, in all of this great enlightened age, there are more and more people spiritually ignorant than ever before. As a matter of fact, I am amazed that I'm faced with more skepticism today than I was in 1958 when I first preached what I'm about to preach to you. Because this is not a new sermon. Somebody said, where'd you get your sermon at? I said, I got it out of the Bible, about 2,000 years old. So this is not original with me, but just like I ask you these questions, most people think that this is just clever ways of saying things. They don't understand that I am the Lord that healeth thee. We got to qualify it and preach it to death by telling you how much faith you have to have. Now they have so much faith, they don't get nothing. They know so much about it that they never receive anything. We no longer believe that God wants to make you rich. And any time any preacher or any church member gets a lot of wealth, everybody looks at them with skepticism. Well, they must be crooks. That's the only thing that the world can come, because the devil does not want you to be blessed, and yet you and I and everybody else I know work as hard as we can to get all that we can, and yet we're skeptical of the person that does actually find wealth. When the Bible says, I want to ask you this question here today. If prosperity is a sin, and if it is a sin for us to be blessed financially, I want to ask you, why does the Bible say, beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health as your soul prospers? Why does the Bible, if God wants you to be poor and scrimping by and criticize those people that are blessed financially, and we're sorry for the state that we're in, when we look around and see other people prosper, let me ask you, why did God put this in the Bible? Deuteronomy 28:2. And all these blessings shall come on thee and overtake thee. Why is that in the Bible? If God wants all of us to be poor, why does it say, blessed shalt thou be the fruit of thy body, your children. Blessed shall be the fruit of thy ground, your crops. Blessed shall be the fruit of thy cattle, or whatever you got your business in, and the flocks of thy sheep. Why does the Bible say, blessed shall be thy basket and thy store? Deuteronomy 28:5. Why does it say, blessed shalt thou be when thou comest in, and blessed shalt thou be when thou goest out? Why has it suddenly become a sin, and we look upon people that do have some money, why is it a sin for God's people to prosper. What I'm telling you right now, if you're looking at it that way, then you're never going to prosper. My first cousin made Fortune 500 magazine, and they asked him for a quote. Here's what he said. I mean, Fortune 500, that's big business. Business, amen. He's up there with, he's so rich now, he won't even talk to me on the phone. But probably too busy. But what happened to him, he said, if you get up every morning thinking about how to get money, eventually you'll figure it out. But if you have this mindset that it's wrong, if you have this guilt, many people feel guilty every time God blesses them. Can you say amen? They want to hide it from everybody. They don't want anybody to know that God has been good to them. Why does God say, if God doesn't want us to have wealth, why does God say, the Lord shall command the blessing upon thee? In other words, God's command. Have you been fighting against the commandment of God? Why does the Bible say, if God doesn't want you to be wealthy and live better than the devil's crowd, if God doesn't want you to be prosperous more than the devil's crowd, I want to ask you right now, why do you think it's wrong for God's people to prosper, but it's all right for those devils to prosper? Why do people think this? Why did God even promise that he'll open unto us his good treasure? If his good treasure is a can of Spam and pork and beans, I'm going to tell you that's not a very good treasure. I'd rather eat a little bit higher on the hog if I'm going to eat hog. Come on, say amen. The Lord will open up to you his good treasure. It says, so shall thy bank be filled with plenty, and thy oil presses shall burst forth with oil and new wine. This is God's promise here. God said to you, See if I will not open unto you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not even be room enough for you to receive it all, and I'll rebuke the devil for your sake. Why does the Bible say this? If God didn't plan on you having some wealth in your lifetime, why does it say all the promises of God are yea and amen to them that believe? Why does the Bible say all of these blessings shall overtake thee? They'll outrun you and wait for you to catch up to them. And the reason is because God said it. God intends for you to have more than enough. Isaiah 61:6, I know a lot of us in this country get upset when we see people outside of our faith prosper. But God said, I'm going to take what they have and I'm going to give it to my people. You shall eat the riches of the Gentiles. You shall lend and not borrow all the days of your life. God said, I will make you plenteous in goods. I will open up to you my good treasure. God is spending a lot of time and speaking a lot in the Bible about wealth and money that he will give unto us because we serve him. Listen to this. Job, that everybody said, well, he lost everything. Listen to this. He said, thou shalt lay up gold as dust, and the gold of Ophir as the stones by the brook. Yea, the Almighty shall be thy defense, and thou shalt have plenty of silver. I'd like to have plenty of silver. Silver is going through the roof right now, all over the world. Everybody wants silver. Everybody said gold for a long time. Now everybody wants silver. If God didn't want you to be hungry, if he wanted you to be hungry, why did God say, your meal barrel shall not waste, neither shall your cruse of oil fail? That means that God is going to give you money. God is going to give us wealth. Listen, you say, well, Brother Ross, you know, I had a sign up here. Deuteronomy 8:18 in my church. God will give you power to get wealth. Some people came in and they were holier than I am. They're so holy that God won't even talk to them anymore. They're holier than God. Anytime you think you know more than what God's word actually says, there's something wrong with you. Ain't nothing wrong with the word of God. God said he would give us power to get wealth. He also said, I will make thy way prosperous, and thou shalt have good success. Joshua 1:8. God's promised this to Joshua if he would meditate in the law of God. It is he that giveth thee power to get wealth. That means the ability to get it. It's not all done by inheritance or the lottery. Instead, God has many ways. You know, you're not going to get it always on the sweepstakes and publisher's clearinghouse. God has other ways to bless you than that. God has ways to bless the work of your hands so that everything you set your hand unto, God is going to make it prosper. Listen, God is going to bless his people. Right now, look at your hand. Hallelujah. That hand should be a blessed hand. That hand, everything it touches, God's going to give it to you. God, that hand right there that God has anointed, everything you touch from now on, from this day forward, God is going to bless it in your hands. God's going to give it back to you. Good measure, heaped up, pressed down, shaken together, and he'll make it run over. And he says to you, with the same measure that you give, he's going to measure it back to you exactly the same. If you give bountifully, God's going to give bountifully back to you. Listen to this, Psalm 105, verse 37. He brought them forth also with silver and gold, and there was not one feeble person among their tribes. In other words, when God brought his people out of, you know, I've often said this, but I was watching one of these things that said all of the tombs have been broken into and grave robbers robbed all the tombs in Egypt. Can I tell you something? I know the days that it happened. It's when they were trying to get rid of the children of God. They were willing to give them anything to get rid of them. Did you know when Solomon came back there and started working on the temple, he had more than 5,000 talents of gold. That's enough gold to build 5 or 6 temples. He had gold left over. They had not only that, but they had the gold of Babylon given to them, the children of God. Not only did they have that, but when Titus destroyed the city of Jerusalem, he had enough wealth to go back and that gold and rebuild all of Rome. He built the Colosseum. He built the circus. He built all of these great, the Arch of Triumph that was in Rome. He built it all with gold that he got out of God's house. Can I tell you something? They had wealth. They knew what money was. There was not one sick one among all of their tribes. And not only that, when they walked out, you see, there wasn't no Kmart. There wasn't no Walmart. There wasn't a grocery store. There wasn't a drug store. There was no place for them to buy food in the wilderness. There was no place for them to, there wasn't no men's warehouse. There was no place for them to get clothes, nothing. And God kept them alive for 40 years in the wilderness. They did not even get a bruise on their foot from walking on stones. The shoes that they had on when they left Egypt, they grew with their body, and when they walked across the Jordan River into the Promised Land, they were wearing the same clothes. God blessed them. Their clothes did not even wear out. God blessed them. Are you saying amen here today? You've got to remember that God is a blessing God. God is not a cursing God. He brought them forth also with silver and gold, and there was not one feeble person among their tribes. 2 Corinthians 8:9. Yet for your sakes he became poor, that because of his poverty you might be made rich. Moreover, I want to ask you something. If riches and wealth is a sin, then why did God say it's a gift? Amen. Ecclesiastes 5:19. Listen carefully now. This is the word of God. This is what, you know, everybody, I had somebody tell me yesterday, putting in a furnace over here. When he got through, he said, he asked me, he says, you're not going to try to Jew me down, are you? And I said, no, I'm going to Christian you down. Amen. You're charging more than you said you would. Well, okay, if you insist. I said, well, I do insist. I want the right price. Come on, say amen. And so he knocked $100 off of it. That's not bad, is it? Hallelujah. And I already had the furnace in. He couldn't repossess it. Come on, say amen. I had a little leverage there. Say praise the Lord. Every man also to whom God hath given riches and wealth. Listen, This says God gives riches and wealth. And not only that, but he gives you the power to enjoy it. To take your portion and to rejoice in your labor that helped you get it. This is the gift of God. Ecclesiastes 5:19. It's a gift of God. Some of you talk about spiritual gifts and you want to say, yea, I say unto somebody. You want to talk about spiritual gifts and have great faith. You want to have spiritual gifts and work miracles. I'm going to tell you something. You ain't going nowhere if you ain't got no money. What? Go over there and tell them on the TV station. You got more faith than anybody else does. What time do I go on? They ain't going to put you on. Come on, go to the newspaper and say, I have more faith than any other preacher ever come to town. They ain't going to give you no space free. Amen. If you're going to do anything for God, and God is going to bless your labor, you're going to have to, and if it's a sin to have it, I'm going to ask you, why would God say it's a gift of God, and if God gives it to you, it's going to be something that's going to be wrong for you? I'm going to tell you, God doesn't give anything that's bad for you. God gives you money. God gives you wealth. God commands a blessing on your hand. God prospers you when you get up in the morning. He prospers you when you come out and prospers you when you go in. God does this and he promised to do it. I'm going to tell you something. God is not going to give you anything that's going to keep your soul from going to heaven. God is not going to give you anything that's going to make you sin. And so money, therefore, it cannot be sin, because if God gives it to you, he gives it to you as a gift of God, and he wants you to enjoy it. He wants you to take your portion. He wants you to enjoy it. He wants you to have eat what's good. This is what this is saying, Ecclesiastes 5:19. It's a supernatural gift from God. I'm going to tell you, the wealth of this world belongs to God. It does not belong to the Christ hater. It does not belong to the sinner man. It does not belong to those people that hate God's people. Instead, the wealth, when they lay down in a bed, it was bought with God's money. Are you listening to me? When they walk into their mansion, it was bought with God's money. That money belonged to you. That money belongs to God's people. It doesn't belong to those people that hate God. This belongs to God's people. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. He opens his hand. It is filled with good. And God has become poor so that you could be made rich through his poverty. This is the plan of God. God wants to bless his people today. And now we're in the right space, at the right place, at the right time. Hallelujah. That word of God even tells you, don't worry about the wicked when they become wealthy. Don't worry about them, because they're going to lay it up. They're going to heap it up, but they're never going to be able to spend it. He said they're putting it into a bag with holes in it, and I'm going to take the wealth of the wicked, and I'm going to give it to my people. You let them go ahead and do what they want to do, because God is going to take it all, and he's going to give it to his people, because it belongs to God, and it's a gift of God to give. Hallelujah. Is anybody seeing what I'm saying here? Riches and wealth and the power to enjoy them according to the scripture. Hallelujah. There's my man. Hallelujah. God has promised too many precious blessings to us. Listen to this. Every good gift, every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither is there any shadow of turning. James 1:17. You put those two scriptures together. It's a gift of God, and every good gift comes from God. This is the Bible talking to us today. What is the gift of God? He says it here. It's riches and wealth, and the power to enjoy it, and the power to rejoice in having it. Hallelujah. Is it any wonder that I got up years ago in 1958 and began to preach this and was met with so much skepticism? But I got to tell you, there is a skeptical attitude now by all of these money grubbers out there trying to get all they can to turn around and condemn you if you got anything. They'll talk you down into the ground if you wear a new hat to church. They'll talk you down if you drive a new car and they're trying to get one themselves. They'll talk you down if you move into a new house and they ain't got something as good as you. Don't listen to them. That's all the devil's plan. If you sow and reap, listen. If you sow and reap, then you enjoy God's blessing without apologizing to anybody. Don't be sorry for how God has been good to you. Don't feel guilty because God has blessed you. This is the plan of God. He said, I wish that you would prosper in these three areas, that you may prosper. That means money, in physical health, physically, and also spiritually. I would that you prosper. God wants you to prosper here today. Somebody said, well, why would God do that for us? Why would God do that for us? I'm going to tell you the greatest reason I can think of. God so loved the world. He gave the best that he had. He gave his only begotten son. After that, everything else is just puro. Hallelujah. It's just the best that there is. There's the best that God has. He wants his children to have the best. God doesn't want you walking around with holes in your shoes. God doesn't want you to walk around with holes in your clothes. God wants you to have the best. You don't have to go outlandish on God, but I promise you that God is going to give his people the best. You're going to live in a house and God's going to give it to you. You're going to wear clothes that God is going to provide for you. You're going to have a job that God gives to you. You're going to have the work of your hands blessed by everything that God does. And I'm telling you right now, there's nothing the devil can do to hinder this. The only thing that is a hindrance to this is if you do not believe it. That's it. That's the only hindrance to this. And we've got a world. Listen, I know preachers driving their Bentleys and their Cadillacs, and they don't even want ordinary cars. They want to get them handmade for them somewhere. But they'll walk out and tell you that it's a sin for us to be blessed and prospered. Yet they're trying everything they can to get what they can. I'm telling you right now, it's foolish for them to say these things. It's foolish to go against the word of God, because God wants his people to be blessed. God doesn't want the preacher blessed more than you. Hello? I said, if you're going to a church where the preacher's living better than you are, there's something wrong with this picture. Is anybody saying amen? You need to understand here, if the preacher can only help himself. I wrote a book years ago, Starving Sheep and Overfed Shepherds. We got people in the church nowadays that are living hand to mouth and they can barely get by, while the preacher's eating steak and whatever else and driving in a fine car and wearing $1,000 suits. Can I tell you something? There's something wrong with this picture. There's something wrong with the picture when only one group of people in the world prospers, and that's the people that are supposed to be helping you get from where you are to where you want to be. I'm telling you right now, I've been there, done that. I've been so poor that baking soda, if you mix it with water and put a little sugar in it, it almost tastes like soda pop. Hallelujah. I fried grits. Hallelujah. But I'm telling you, grits ain't groceries. What, and eggs ain't poultry. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Any blues people in here been singing the blues? Well, you know what I'm saying. Hallelujah. And grits ain't groceries and eggs ain't poultry. Hallelujah. The thing is, I'm trying to tell you, I've been there and done that. I don't want to go back to that. I don't want to go back to living without. I enjoy the blessings of God too much, and I'm not ashamed of it. I have sowed, and now God is letting me reap. If you sow, you're going to reap also. If you give, you shall receive good measure, heaped up, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, because God is going to command the blessing on. This is the gift of God. He returns to you not a little bit. He returns to you more than enough. And your faith determines it. Jesus said, I bless some 30 times. I bless some 60 times. I bless some 100 times. You can choose your blessing here. You can believe God and God will give it back to you. Good measure. Whatever you choose, whatever level you want to be on. I shouldn't interrupt this and tell you a true story, because everybody tells me when you start telling these testimonials, these stories, you get off the point. This makes my point. My grandmother was a precious woman. She was a good woman. She taught me how to pray. She taught me how to read the Bible. She told me, whenever you have need, son, get on your knees, and God will answer your prayer. She taught me how to read the Bible and how to understand it. I never forgot what my grandmother did for me. Now listen to this. I went up north. I went to Indiana. And when I got there, you know, God began to bless me. A.A. Allen hired me. William Branham hired me. I went with two of the greatest preachers there were. I got a little change in my pockets. When I worked for A.A. Allen, I never worried about what I wore. We'd go out and shopping. He'd buy me as many clothes as he got. I never worried about a car, because he had three or four cars. I could drive one of his. I never worried about where I was going to stay, because he took me everywhere and provided for me. Isn't that great? So I had a little money. Had a little change in my pocket. I went down to Kentucky. I went up on Bad Creek. That's where my grandmother was living. On Cold Fork of Bad Creek. If you don't know where that is, that's a little bit distance from Asher, Kentucky. You know, John Schott's grocery store. It's right there on the river, and you turn there. What I did is I couldn't imagine. Now listen, we don't know. Even when things are bad, we don't know how good we got it. Are you listening to me? We don't know how good we got it even when times are bad. You want to hear about bad times? You know how they got the house warm? I went out and dug coal out of the side of the hill and carried it back in a bucket and dumped it in the fireplace. You want to know how we ate? I'd go hunting. I'm going to tell you how. Somebody asked me, Brother Ross, how did you get so good shooting? Because I didn't want to tear up the meat of the animal that I had to kill. So I got good enough that I did what my uncle used to call creasing. That's where you'd shoot the animal right here in the back of the head and cut the spine, and it would die, and you didn't mess up any of the meat. Because we ate everything except the tail. It had hair all over. We had and the skin. We didn't eat that part. Everything else we ate. We didn't have that good. It was rough living. That's the way I started out. But see, I couldn't imagine anymore my grandmother getting up and having to break the ice on the spring to dip water out, to get up and go out and milk a cow in order to have milk to drink, to get out and work in a cornfield in order to have cornbread to eat. I got tired of that, thinking of her living and sleeping in an old metal bed with a feather mattress, a feather bed, laying on that, and the spring sometimes sticking right through there. I couldn't stand it anymore. And I said, I promise God, if you ever do good, here's what I did. I went down and I bought a piece of land. I built a house on it. I built it. I had guys do the work, build it. I had not running water. I had the well right inside the house where you could just pump the handle and water would come out. Indoor toilet. Boy, we was up moving on up down there. I could just see it. They're going to run an ad about a story about her in the paper and talk about this beautiful house. And so one day, I went down there and I got my grandmother in the car. And I said, where are we going? Well, we're going to go. I just want to look around. I haven't been here for a while. So we drive around. I hired some people. They went there to her house and got all of her precious stuff. You know, the stuff I knew she wouldn't part with. And I had it moved over there into that new house. And so we pulled, and she said, "Oh, who lives here?" I said, "Well, let's go in and see." So we went in there, and we walked in the door, and she was walking real light, you know, like she didn't want to mess up the carpet. And she said, "Oh, these people have a couch just like mine. These people have a dresser." And she said, "Look at that mirror over there on the wall. That's exactly like the mirror I..." And then she started looking at the pictures, and she said, "Wait a minute. This is my family. Whose house is this?" And I told her. I told her the story. I said, "I built this house for you. This is your house. Yeah, it's got indoor heating. You never have to go dig coal out of the hill again to have warmth in here." And I said, "I've got a bank account for you. Anything you need, any bill that you have, I'm paying them all in advance. You'll never have to worry about money the rest of your life. You can live here and be happy." She lived there for 2 weeks. Hired a man to haul all of her stuff back to the house she moved out of. Listen now. That don't seem reasonable, does it? The poor was not in her bank account. The poor was not in the house she lived in. The poor was not in the clothes she was wearing. The poor was not because she had unpaid bills. The poor was in here. Y'all ain't gonna get that one this morning. But I'm gonna tell you, a lot of us limit ourselves by our own attitudes about what is rich and what is poor. I have sat down before. "Oh, you know, I'm kind of cosmopolitan, aren't I? I mean, you know, I've been around. I've been around the world a couple times. I've been to foreign countries. I've shook hands with kings and had queens laid their hand on me and tell me how wonderful I was and all that. I've been around. I've done things. I've gone to colleges in foreign countries. I've got degrees. I've got a wall full of them up there. I've been around." Listen to this. I was a vice president of United Cerebral Palsy in California, Central Valley. Here I was. I got invited out to a rich man's house. Very rich. I mean, extremely rich, owned so much. And he said, "Oh," he said, "I'm so glad to see that you came, Ross. I've got a special place for you at the head of the table." And they brought me down there and they set me down. And I'm sitting there because they went on talking. They just ignored me after that. I was sitting there and I looked at these gold plates. I'll tell you what a hillbilly I am. I picked it up and turned it over to see what the stamp was on it. It was gold. 14K. Here's a gold goblet for water. Didn't have any water in it, so I didn't spill anything on the tablecloth. And so I looked at the bottom of it, 18 karat gold. I looked at the flatware. It was all gold. And I sat there and I pulled into myself. And I said, "Oh, I shouldn't be here. This is too good for me. When I get to heaven, I'm going to walk right in and make myself at home." I didn't know it right then, but those people cared so much for me. If I'd have taken that gold and put it in my pocket and walked out with it, they'd have laughed about it and say, "Hey, you want some more? Hallelujah." When you get a lot of money, it doesn't matter to you. But the thing is, the devil wants to keep you poor in here. He wants you to think, "Well, they deserve that. They need that. They're better than I." Hey, listen, ain't nobody better in this world than God's people. We're the best people in the world. God has put you in this world for a reason. You're called of God. You're anointed of God. You're blessed of God. You have God's DNA living in your spirit on the inside of you. You belong to God. You are God's child. If anybody offers it to you, go ahead and say, "Thank you, Jesus." Don't say it's too good for you, and don't let the thought get in your mind that somebody should be living better than you. Instead, God has blessed us. Hold a hand out again and look at it and say, that's a blessed hand right there. Turn around and show it to somebody and say, see that hand? That's a blessed hand right there. And I got two of them for a double portion. God wants to bless me. God wants to command a blessing on me. Listen, does the devil have a gift? The answer is yes. The devil has a gift. He has a gift that is the direct opposite of God. God wants you free. The devil wants you bound. God wants you to serve him. The devil wants you to serve him. Everything that God has, the devil has tried to make a substitute to it. You get a word from the Lord, the devil will come along and try to give you a different word. So you'll be wandering around, well, which one's right? Which one's right? Amen. Satan uses poverty. Satan uses poverty to keep us down. I'm going to tell you, it's a lie of the devil to tell you that you cannot do, you know, George Washington Carver, anybody remember him? He died yesterday in 1949. He was born a slave. Here, George Washington Carver educated himself when nobody wanted to help him. He went to school when nobody wanted to help him. He worked his way through and did it. He did everything. He did. You know what I'm telling you right now? If you want it bad enough and you serve God with your heart, God is going to make a way for you. Your gift is going to make room for you. God is going to open a door for you, and no man can shut it. When God begins to bless you, you're going to be like a snowball rolling down a hill. You're going to get bigger every time you turn around. God is going to command a blessing on you, and the devil, listen, every day of your life, the devil is going to try to take away from you what God has given to you. You say, well, I made it now. No, you haven't made it now. You don't make it till the door's slammed and on the coffin and you're down. You're done. That's when you can say, I've done all that I can do, because you can't do anything after that. But you know something? The devil is going to fight you every day of your life. He's going to try to take it away from you. He's going to lie to you. He's going to try to deceive you in your mind. And he'll use edumacated people to come along and tell you stuff that's an outright lie. Would people lie to you? Yes! The devil is a liar. What do you think he's doing sitting around here? He's making up lies on you right now. He's going to lie about you, and he's going to lie to you, and he's going to send people to you. And the Word of God said, a demon came and stood before God, and he said, I'll go down and become a lying spirit in the mouth of the prophets. We got preachers today that have lying spirits in them. They're up here lying to God's people. And the devil blesses them. He gives them enough money to buy time on TV. And he don't want you on TV. He don't want you being blessed. He don't want your music selling. He don't want you to have a door of opportunity. He doesn't want you to get up. He doesn't want. And the very thing is, every time you try to get up, the devil's going to have somebody come out and reach out and try to pull you back down. The devil is a liar. He's going to lie about you, and he's going to lie to you. That's what the devil does. He's not going to change his mind, because he knows he has but a short time. He'll come along and give you politicians and leaders, not just here in America, but around the world. I'm going to tell you, if you join yourself, listen to me, watch me. If you join yourself to somebody that ain't got nothing, never did anything, don't have any money, never hopes to have any money, and got a bad attitude about it, don't think you're going to change that person. They'll drag you down. You want to know how I know that? Because 3/4 of the world is poor. They don't have anything. And they get mad at everybody that does have anything. They hate America, but they can't wait to get here. We've got to understand something. God has a blessing for us. God has a blessing for His people. And God has poured out a blessing not on this nation. Don't extrapolate this here. God has not blessed this whole nation. God doesn't bless a lot of things that the devil does. It costs them their soul. Have you looked at some of these people that have made great wealth in this world? Look what their life has turned out to be. I don't like the devil's blessing. I don't like the devil's cursing. I don't like the devil's gifts, because it always costs you your soul and costs you your life. But when it comes to God, the blessing of the Lord maketh rich, and He addeth no sorrow. The blessing of the Lord lifteth up. Hallelujah. I want to get the blessing of God. I want that joy of getting up in the morning. Hallelujah. I want that joy. I want joy enough in my heart to praise the Lord. You got to do this. You got to come along with me here. Because I'm promising you right now. The Lord, let the Lord be magnified, which hath pleasure in the prosperity of His servants. I'm the servant of the Lord. Psalm 35, verse 27. That's me it's talking about. Every time I get blessed, God gets pleasure out of it. Oh, bless me, Lord. I want to give God a lot of pleasure in my life. Hallelujah. I want to get so blessed and so prospered that it'll make the devil mad and make all of God's people be inspired. Hallelujah. I want you to get blessed so much, hallelujah, that you move out of that house with Brother Rat and Sister Roach and move on. I'm moving on up to the east side. I want you to get your piece of the pie. Piece of the rock. I'm not here. Listen, I know what these lousy, stinking, no good, doubting wimps want to tell you, that it's pie in the sky when you die, by and by, one of these old days. Oh, one of these old days we're going to cross over Jordan. One of these old days we're going to have a mansion up in the sky. One of these old days we're going to walk on streets of gold. Listen, what you think there's a Walmart in heaven that you need gold for? Hallelujah. I don't need gold in heaven. I need gold here. I don't believe in... Listen, by the way, in the sweet by and by, that song was a union work song written by Woody Guthrie. Where I'll eat pie in the sky by and by, in the sweet by and by, when all the food is for free. When we work and our work is play, I will eat pie in the sky by and by. That's what they were selling to everybody. They were selling the idea, well, put up with it down here, because when you get over there, everything, listen, God doesn't want you sick down here. God wants to heal you. God wants to heal you now. God don't want to put it off. God doesn't want you to be poor down here. He wants you to have an abundant life. God wants to bless you coming in and bless you going out. He wants to command a blessing on the work of your hands. He wants you to be happy in the morning and when you get up in the morning. And He wants you to be happy at night. He doesn't want you praying like some people do. Oh God, it's another morning. Prophet Isaiah said, in the morning they'll say, I would to God it was night. And at nighttime they'll say, I would to God it was morning. They have no joy, no matter what they do. Have you ever met such a bunch of sad sack Christians in your life, walking around with long faces and look like they just been sucking on pickles? Hallelujah. I want to tell you something. Get that sour taste out of your mouth. Come on over and eat some milk and honey. Hallelujah. Eat on the word of God. It may be bitter at first, but after you begin eating, it becomes like honey in your mouth. Can anybody say amen? This honey is going to keep you alive. Hallelujah. This honey from the word of God is going to lift you up and give you joy, and give you joy, unspeakable joy, and full of glory. Hallelujah. Listen to this. Here it is. I'm going to lay this on you now. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you one thing that you probably don't know. Right here in Detroit. Listen to this. Right here in Detroit. Not someplace else. Not way over there somewhere. Right here in Detroit. In the Federal Reserve. Right here in Detroit. There is $11 billion in unclaimed money. Unclaimed. I think I ought to go down there and march around that Federal Reserve a couple of times, seven times till the walls come tumbling down. Come on, say amen. The reason I'm saying this, listen to this. This is it now. This is Job 27, verse 16 and 17. This is it now. Hold on to this. Don't doubt this. Listen, don't be skeptical about God blessing you. Don't sit there and say, well, that's for somebody else. It's not for me. Get that poor attitude. Get that lying devil out of your head. Don't say that's for somebody else. That's in some, all the gold in California is in the middle of bank in Beverly Hills in somebody else's name. No, that's a song. It's not the truth. All that gold out there belongs to my Father. All that money down here in this Federal Reserve building being held, that belongs to God. Amen. They don't even know who it belongs to. It's been so many years, they don't know who owns it. Maybe Charles the 15th of France came over here and built all that money down here. I don't know. Hallelujah. Listen to this. Are you ready? If you forget everything else, don't forget this. Because when you look around and you, does anybody ever get out and drive through big neighborhoods and rich neighborhoods? Do you do that? I get out and drive down Jefferson every once in a while to see how all the rich peoples live. I like to see them big mansions there and try to figure out. Now, I wonder how much their real estate taxes bill is. I guess if you live there, you don't care what the taxes are. If you had enough money to buy it, you got enough money to pay for it. Amen. Hallelujah. Listen, this is my scripture now. I drove down Jefferson the other day. I was on my way somewhere. Kate wanted to get out and ride around in the sunshine. That's probably where she got the cold at. Or the flu or whatever. So we're driving down through there. And I said, well, Kate, which one of them houses do you like? Which one would you like to have? Listen to this now. Though the wicked heap up silver as the dust and prepare raiment as the clay, that's not bad. That means it's been baked and it's shiny and glossy. He may prepare it, but where's my but God bracelets? I need to give everybody one to remind you of that again. Whatever the devil says, but God. Hallelujah. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God delivers him. Listen to this. He may prepare it. He may heap it up as dust. He may put on the most beautiful clothes and prepare raiment so they're beautiful. He may prepare it, but the just shall put it on, and the innocent shall divide the silver. In other words, what this says to me is God is going to take the wealth of the devil. I don't care how he got it. He's been drilling up God's oil out of the ground, saying it belongs to him. He should meet the EPA here and the Environmental Protection Agency. They should go over there and try to pass those laws on Saudi Arabia that they pass on people here, where you can't even drill on your own land. If rain falls on your land, you can't even hold it. You can't even build a dam and keep water on your own land. It doesn't belong to you. It belongs to the people down the way somewhere. Well, didn't it rain down there? We got a bunch of crazy people in this world. The devil is intent on stopping you. He makes plans to stop you from prospering. The devil will do anything to keep you from getting ahead in life. Now listen, I'm on a different level here. I'm not talking just about getting a nice house for you to live in and bring the grands in and all that and live nice forever and have enough money to take care of your own. Because if you get some money, you're going to have relatives you never heard of. You get some money, you're going to meet your enlarged family. They'll find you. You don't have to look for them anymore. They'll come and find you. You get some money. What I'm trying to say here is this. The devil is going to do everything he can, but he cannot keep your blessing away from you. The devil is a liar. He's doing everything. You say, well, Brother Ross, how come I ain't rich right now? Well, you're a lot richer right now than a lot of people are. Let's be thankful for what we already got. Is anybody willing to do that with me? How many's glad you can wiggle your fingers this morning? Hallelujah. How many glad you could use your feet this morning? How many glad you could see this morning and hear this morning and talk this morning and you were clothed and in your right mind this morning? How many glad about that this morning? How many said, it's another day's journey and I'm glad about it? Hallelujah. Well, you and I need to know this. We've got to learn how to be thankful for what God has already done for us. You know, ain't nobody more ungrateful than me. Ask people around me, people that know me personally. I walk around and say, look at all these stinking bills I got to pay. Look at all this stuff I got to do. Furnace is going out. One goes out, and I get it fixed, borrow money to get it fixed, and then all of a sudden, here goes another one out. Have to pay the same amount of money. Two of them. I got 11 furnaces in here. That's a lot of them. But that's a good thing. I don't have to heat everything to get one area hot. So that's smart, isn't it? Is that smart? I complain about everything. Look at that. Two furnaces within a month. Why didn't those furnaces go out in the summertime? Amen. I complain about cars. I ain't got nothing to complain about the car I got. I know it may be 12, 14 years old, but it's the best car I ever drove in my life. It's got almost 200,000 miles on it. I mean, ain't nothing gone wrong with it. Now that I say that, the devil will probably attack it. I wouldn't put it past him. Huh? But just think, Brother Ross, if you hadn't bought that church building, you could have had a Bentley like the rest of them. You could be walking, you'd go around in Brioni suits instead of those little cheap suits from Calvin, what's his name? Amen. I promise you right now, you can complain about anything. But I got up this morning thankful. Amen. I got up this morning thankful. I got up this morning and I said, thank you, Lord. I don't have to go out and preach on the street. Come on, church. Say, when I started out, I preached on the street. Amen. Amen. Anybody ever preach on the street? It's a trip. You get out and preach on the street, they'll throw rocks at you. I got scars here on my head where they threw rocks at me. I got stab marks on my legs where I got stabbed. They were coming at my heart. They came up behind me with a knife, and it was a switchblade knife. They came up behind me, and you know, I had a bad habit when I first started preaching, but the church got me out of that bad habit. They ridiculed me down to dirt. They called me nothing, because I'd feel the power of God, I'd go, glory! That was just, when I said glory, that's when he came up behind me and he got me here. He was coming for here. Huh. Isn't that good? If I go out and preach on the street, you'll see me do that a lot. Hallelujah. And the guy, it scared him so bad because I did that, he took off running down the street. And I looked down because it hurt. Did it hurt? Yes, it hurt. I pulled that knife out and I said, "Hey, mister, you forgot your knife." But I was being funny. I was hoping he'd come back for it. You and I need to understand something. I'm thankful to have a church preaching. I had one of my old-time friends from years ago write me, because I put on there, you know, as time goes on, as the church gets more worldly, I become more and more Pentecostal. I can't help it. I become more holiness now. As the world gets more worldly, I get more holiness in me. Hallelujah. I can't help it. I get more on fire for God now, hallelujah, because the world, the church is getting worse and worse. We got to hold on to God and stay at the old landmark in the service of God. And I, you know, and one of my friends wrote me, "Well, not me." And I said, "What do you mean, not you? You don't, well, I don't want to go back to that." I said, "You don't go anywhere unless that evangelist pays you. A big-time operator pays you. Everybody here probably got mail from him at once. It's a thousand of thousands of dollars a week business. They take in lots of money." And I said, "Well, you don't have to get up and preach." I said, "Me, I love church. I love getting up on Sunday morning. I can't help it. I want to get out and preach. I preach so long, you all can't stand it sometimes." Bill and my wife said, "You just preach too long." I said, "Can't you see how much I'm enjoying it? I'm having the time of my life." Amen. Somebody said, "Why do you study so much? And why do you prepare all of this so much?" And I said, "Well, why wouldn't I?" And they said, "Well, ain't that many people coming to your ministry anymore?" And I said, "I ain't just preaching for these people. I'm preaching because God called me to preach." Amen. The reason I went out and preached on the street is because no church would have me. I was too young. Everybody's always going, and you know what? Everybody's going to try to discourage you from doing everything that God tells you to do. But here is the good thing. The wealth of the sinner is laid up in your name. It's going to come to you. If it doesn't come to you, you say, "Well, Brother Ross, what's the Lord waiting for?" God is waiting for somebody, just like the Federal Reserve down there. They're waiting for somebody to come down there and claim the money. In the spirit, God is waiting for somebody to claim the blessing. That's all you have to do. Join hands with somebody now. Amen.